Now, Frank, aren't you exaggerating a little bit? Is grain-fed beef really poison? Depends on what you mean. If you're talking about conventional feedlot American beef, absolutely poison. But if you're talking about that farmer that supplements his grass-fed cow with some high-quality organic grain, two completely different things. The evil here is conventional agriculture, things that have gone astray with our modern food system. We're going to focus on several aspects of conventional farming today. If you haven't seen my video, The Life of a Feedlot Cow, definitely check that out. And I also did a video titled, Grain-Fed Beef Will Make You Fat and Flabby, where I spoke about estrogenic herbicides such as atrazine. I won't be talking about atrazine today. However, I did have someone with firsthand experience reach out to me that has seen this ugly side of modern agriculture. And there are common procedures in these feedlot beef operations that result in tortured animals and poisonous meat. First, we have dehorning and tail docking. Horns are removed from all animals to prevent injury to others and make handling easier. This very stressful process involves sawing or chopping off the horns and then cauterizing the wound to prevent excess blood loss. Tail docking is used to prevent cattle from getting their tail stuck between the floors of the barn. It's very painful and commonly causes infection at the docking site. Second is antibiotics. Your meat that's labeled antibiotic-free simply means that the levels of antibiotics at the time of slaughter was deemed reasonable. How's that sound? Many different forms of antibiotics are injected into the neck of the animal if they are deemed to be sick or as a preventative measure for shipping fever, which is a range of diseases typically triggered by shipping stress. Most feedlots mass treat their animals, which means giving antibiotics to all cattle upon arrival at the feedlot. These antibiotics are closely related to the ones used for human purposes. Feed-grade antibiotics, such as chlortetracycline, oxytetracycline, and sulfamethazine, are added to the feed to reduce instances of disease and promote overall growth. Certain regulations require veterinarians to write case-by-case prescriptions, but most veterinarians don't even inspect the cattle and will simply write the prescription at the request of the feedlot. Cases of antibiotic-resistant bacteria continue to increase, and feedlots are using more powerful drugs every year to combat the same infections. The reason people are getting sick from Salmonella and E. coli isn't that those bacteria are inherently harmful, it's that once you put them in this toxic feedlot environment, they become powerful and antibiotic resistant, therefore can now harm humans. We also have ionophores, which are antibiotics that are essentially given the classification of medically unimportant. Therefore, they are not regulated. Ionophores are used to improve feed efficiency and prevent certain parasites. Cattle receive these drugs from the moment they enter the feedlot until the day they leave. The most commonly used ionophore is Rumensin, which is made by Elanco. Third, we have growth promotants. Estrogenic implants containing estradiol and trenbolone acetate are given to cattle up to 4 times throughout their lives. These change the hormonal profile of cattle, causing them to eat more and gain additional weight. This also has a negative impact on meat quality, you know, explaining some of the drastic differences between feedlot and local beef. Beta agonists are another type of growth promotant, which cause the animal to prioritize muscle growth over fat deposition within the carcass. This results in more lean body mass and less subcutaneous and intramuscular fat tissue. This is like a bodybuilder using steroids on a McDonald's diet. It's preventing the negative health effects through artificial means. Fourth are dewormers, which are used extensively on all feedlot animals. Many different types of dewormers are mixed and matched due to parasite resistance buildup of older drugs. Most of these have an extremely short withdrawal time, which leaves a high amount of these drugs remaining in the tissues. Fifth is vaccines. Something I get asked a lot about. Cattle are given up to 15 different vaccines throughout their lives. All of these vaccines contain heavy metals and other toxic carriers that cause a severe inflammatory and immune response within the body. Cattle frequently go into anaphylactic shock. upon injection from the heavy metals and vaccine endotoxin, resulting in death. These vaccines are administered with needles, which cause abscesses and infections at the injection site, severely damaging tissue. Not pretty. As me. Up sixth, we have vitamin and mineral injections, many of these cattle being deficient in nutrients essential to health. The vitamin B complex is an injection used to treat neurological issues, sometimes called brainers. Brainers are the result of a high grain and high energy diet, depleting the B vitamin stores of the animal, leading it to a quick neurological degeneration and death. Selenium deficiencies are common in young calves, which cause white muscle disease. This is due to the mother not having enough fresh green grass prior to giving birth. Vitamins A, E, and D are given as injections to reduce the oxidative stress the cattle are suffering due to incorrect diet and high stress living. Many animals are injected with broad spectrum vitamin and mineral supplements upon arrival in order for them to have the immune capacity to handle vaccine stimulus. Seven is foot baths. There is a new disease called hairy wheelwort, which is an infection causing severe swelling, pain, and gradual rotting of the hooves of the cattle. There is no effective treatment preventing this, so they have to use a formaldehyde bath, which burns the infection as well as part of the hoof. However, it will return in 1 to 2 months after this bath, so they have to do it on a monthly basis. Direct sunlight and dry ground kill the disease, but those animals are in such horrible conditions, they can't have those simple things. Last, we have veterinary kickbacks. Each pharmaceutical company has incentive programs for both producers and veterinarians to use their products. These programs end up being very profitable for veterinarians and can sometimes be up to 70% of their total yearly profit. Sounds like the doctor that was causing my grandma's brain to rot away on statins. Despicable. Each vet clinic gets a different level of kickback depending on the volume they buy, and that most certainly makes a difference in deciding which products to use on a farm. With pharmaceuticals making up the vast majority of a vet's paycheck, they are very much incentivized to push these products onto the producers they work with. Many times vets will recommend using expensive antibiotics even when it may not be necessary. Most pharmaceutical companies will even send their own sales reps directly to producers to sell them on products without a vet's input. This whole scenario is really scary. Not only do you realize what's being done to these animals, how they're being treated, this occurs across all fields of conventional agriculture, whether it's pork, poultry, how your vegetables are being grown, how your grains are being grown. There's all this cruel, despicable, you know, poisonous stuff that's going on in our food supply. And what makes it even worse is the people in charge have so much money, so much control of the infrastructure. You know, it's bad. You know, when you start supporting carnivores or really anyone, this is the message that they're purveying. When they say, eat the beef you like and can afford, and they're trying to sound nice, and they're trying to like sound like, oh, you're approved for buying expensive grass-fed beef. Do you see what they're supporting? Do you understand what goes into these feedlot conventional beef operations? This is pure evil. You know, yesterday we spoke about, you know, those Harvard scientists supporting, you know, age-old beliefs of genital mutilation in some capacity. The face value of what these people are portraying, oh, it's affordable, it's what people need to eat, you'll do great on an all-beef carnivore diet. These people are excellent at creating the illusion to suck you in so they can make more money off of your poor health. Listen, guys, I understand. Not everyone can afford to go to local farms and buy grass-fed beef. But if you can only afford to spend $2 or $3 a pound on conventional ground feedlot beef every day, you know, go to the local Asian market, go to your grocery store, look for wild caught fatty fish. That's affordable. It's in that $2 to $4 a pound range. And if you can't afford to eat only meat, eat some minimally inflammatory plant foods. Don't consume, you know, 2 to 3 pounds of estrogenic feedlot beef per day. Let's be smart about this. You know, if you're in a developmental stage of life, a young person, a child, a toddler, that's where nutrition is incredibly important. And if you can't afford to put money in the most important thing in your life, I don't know what to tell you. You need to straighten your priorities. That's why on Frankie's Free Range Meat, we are literally the most affordable grass-fed beef purveyor online. It's also why I'm still driving a 2001 Ford Taurus. And for those of you saying, oh, Frank is just trying to sell his grass-fed beef, guys, I'm from New York City. We're the grain-fed steakhouse capital of the world. Peter Luger's, Keen's, Gallagher's, like, grain, I could have sold so much, I could have made so much money off of feedlot steak, it's unbelievable. I wish I would have done that, because, I mean, honestly, at this point, like, I'm getting crucified by everyone else for spreading a message I truly believe in. All I can really do is continue to share my message. So guys, please like the video, subscribe, hit that bell icon. Above all, please share the video. If you do want to support me further, check out my book, The Ancestral Indigenous Diet, down in the description below. Thanks again for joining me, guys. Enjoy the rest of your day.